This is an engine mount, and we're about to use it to mount the engine to the subframe. Now, I hear you. Alex, that's just a block of rubber. And yes, you'd be right, it is a block of rubber. But of course, I got a bit carried away and I made 5 pages of notes. So, let's get stuck in and learn absolutely everything there is to know about engine mounts. So, what does an engine mount do? Well, it does 2 things. First, it attaches the engine to the rest of the car. Now, the simple way to hold the engine would be to just grab a couple of big bolts and bolt the engine down to the body. But the engine is a hive of mechanical activity. There are things spinning around, moving up and down. There's about 50 gas detonations every second at high revs. And inevitably, no matter how perfectly balanced the engine is, that creates a lot of vibration. And if the engine was just directly bolted to the vehicle body, it would transmit those vibrations straight into the rest of the car, and driving would be a bone-hammering experience. You see what we go through for you guys? You can see the vibrations from the engine by putting a bowl of water on the roof of a car, and the vibrations are most noticeable at idle, and they tend to smooth out as the revs increase. So, engine mounts have a second purpose. In addition to just holding the engine in place, they dampen these vibrations and stop them traveling into the rest of the car. Not only do we have the vibration from the engine out into the rest of the car, but there's also other things that cause engine movement. Bumps in the road, accelerating and decelerating, and the torque of the engine itself. Now, there's a lot of inertia inside the motor, and when the engine speeds up or slows down, or the revs go up very quickly or go down, the engine wants to twist on its mounts. You can see this when you have the hood open and you hit the throttle, and there's a rocking movement inside the engine. So the engine mounts need to restrain this movement. Big, modified, high-powered muscle cars used to have a chain that would tie the top of the engine block to some strong, rigid, sturdy parts of the engine bay, an actual metal chain to restrain the engine. Dealing with this vibration is part of a field of automotive engineering called NVH, or noise, vibration, and harshness. We'll have a whole episode on that later, but briefly, noise is, well, noise. From the engine, the road, airflow, whatever. Vibration is obvious, but harshness is something else. That's a measure of how noise and vibration actually feel. And sometimes a certain vibration frequency or noise feels good. A purring engine, a smooth road, gently swinging in a hammock. And other frequencies feel uncomfortable, whining, scraping, or knocking. And this feeling is what harshness refers to. Let's get back to engine mounts. Now, what you might not realize is that the drivetrain in a vehicle is completely isolated from the rest of the bodywork. There's no solid metal connection between any parts of the drivetrain and the rest of the car. The drivetrain being the engine, the transmission, the differential, all the way out to the wheels. And at every connection point, there is some form of soft damper. On this car, we have only 4 points where the drivetrain is connected to the body. 2 rubber engine mounts and 2 rubber mounts at the back of the differential. And since the exhaust is bolted directly onto the engine, it's also isolated from the bodywork using rubber exhaust hangers. Not only does this isolation make for a more comfortable experience, it also gives the engine an easier life because there's somewhere for this vibration energy to go. It's not just shaking itself to pieces. So, engines are fitted to the body, or in our case, the subframe, using engine mounts or motor mounts. And the mounts for this engine are as simple as they get, just a block of rubber. A typical rear-wheel drive car, like this one, will have a mount on either side of the engine, and often a third one that supports the transmission further back. Although not on this car, because we have a backbone called a power plant frame that supports the transmission. Front-wheel drive cars tend to have 3 mounts for the engine in a triangular pattern. And by the way, transmission mounts and engine mounts are exactly the same thing. Occasionally, an engine will include an upper mount, which prevents rocking of the engine by tying it to the bodywork inside the engine bay. That's a more refined version of the chain that we talked about used in muscle cars. And normally, these upper mounts are a tie bar with rubber bushings, again, to isolate vibration from the bodywork. And a bushing, incidentally, is a cylinder of rubber that acts as a vibration absorber, where two parts are bolted together. We're going to come across them mainly on the suspension and the steering systems. Simple mounts like these are made up of two separate metal plates laminated together by a chunk of solid rubber. Now these are blocks, but they can also be disc-shaped. Studs are welded onto the plates, and note that these studs don't run through the rubber. One plate bolts onto the subframe, and the other onto this support bracket, which attaches to the engine block. As usual, the design of engine mounts is a trade-off. Soft mounts will isolate more of the vibration, but they'll allow more engine movement. Firmer mounts will restrict movement more, but they're going to transmit much more vibration. Now, to get technical, engine mounts should ideally be frequency responsive. There are basically two types of shaking that this engine mount should handle. To use everyday terms, these are vibration and bouncing. Now, intuitively, you know the difference between vibration and bouncing, even if you can't explain it in scientific terms. Bouncing is low frequency, high amplitude, and vibration is high frequency, low amplitude. Now, vibration comes from inside the engine, from unbalanced engine forces, imbalances in the rotating and reciprocating parts, and from the firing pulses. Bouncing comes from driving along on uneven road surfaces, accelerating and decelerating, and the torque from the engine. And we want the mount stiff to prevent bouncing, but soft to isolate and absorb vibrations. So the stiffness of an engine mount would ideally be frequency dependent. Stiff at low frequencies and softer at high frequencies. And this block of rubber has been engineered as far as possible to meet these two goals. And you can see that there's a part of where one of the metal plates, and it curves around, leaving two ears that help dissipate vibrations at a certain frequency. It's a bit like a tuning fork. Now, in about the 80s, manufacturers began introducing hydraulic engine mounts, or hydro mounts. These are hollow rubber cushions filled with a liquid, and these absorbed more vibration without allowing too much movement. But they're expensive to make, and they are less durable than the solid rubber mounts like this. More recently, active engine mounts have been developed, and these respond to the specific RPM of the engine, a bit like noise-cancelling headphones. And commonly, these are vacuum controlled, where the computer uses a vacuum to control the stiffness of a mount. And more fancy types of active mounts are controlled with electromagnets or even electromagnetic fluids, or a motor with a counterweight inside the mount itself that moves in an opposing pattern to the engine's vibration. Okay, so what's the failure mode of an engine mount? Well, like all rubber parts, they'll deteriorate with age. Some mounts are going to last the lifetime of the vehicle, and others are going to need replacing at some point. But basically, the rubber will break down, leading to cracks, and the mount may lose its dampening capacity, so you'll get excessive vibration inside the car, or the mount becomes weak and breaks, and the engine will start rocking excessively, particularly when you're changing revs or you're accelerating or decelerating quickly. So knocking noises from the engine bay should have you looking at the engine mounts. And if one mount goes, then the rest are probably on their way out too. So it's generally best to replace mounts as a complete set, since they'll all tend to fail around the same time. The process of replacing mounts is basically to take the weight off the mounts with a jack under the engine and replace the mounts. I'll fit these engine mounts onto the engine and get it onto the subframe. And then we can move on to something a bit more exciting. Who am I kidding? These are exciting! The mount fits onto the supporting bracket with a square hole that locates there, and it's easiest to tighten this nut up in a vise. this mount should actually be covered in rubber all the way, but I'm reusing an old one because I don't have any new ones yet. That's good and tight. We can now fit this to the engine. The mount fits to three holes on the block, and it can only fit to three particular holes, so there's no danger of putting it in the wrong place. There's a plate that goes underneath, and we have two water drain holes here. These need to be at the bottom. You can fit it either way. This goes at the bottom, like that. And it hopefully just locates and holds itself, and we can crane this back onto the subframe. On one side of the subframe, we have a hole, and that's the one we should fit in first. And then on the other, we have a slot, and we should use the slot for the second, and that guides the mount into position. But it's always a bit tricky getting these engines onto the subframe. And the mount is secured to the subframe with a washer and a 14mm nut through the turret. I feel like this is a bit of a milestone. We've got the engine essentially finished and mounted in the car. I think we're almost finished, basically. We've just got the suspension, the rest of the subframe, electrical systems, the transmission, basically everything else to do. However, this is a milestone. I feel happy about this. And I think moving this around on this little trolley and assembling it on this kind of stand, it's going to be absolutely brilliant. So, join us next time. I'm not sure what we'll do. Maybe the serpentine belts. We'll see. Guys, if you enjoyed that episode on engine mounts and you like that level of detail, then come over to howacarworks.com, where I have a whole 20 hours or more, probably by the time you watch this, of videos that explain every part of a modern car and take you step by step from knowing nothing to knowing more than nothing. It's a brilliant series. You'll enjoy it. Join me over there.